I'm Mark Clark.
And I'm Evan Bean.
We're here in a relatively new development to talk about some of those innovative stormwater approaches as part of the treatment train. Typically, we'd have rainwater falling on this parking lot and it's got to go somewhere to be managed. But where we're standing, it's got to flow through this particular system to get to an outlet. So can you tell us a little bit what's going on here?
Well, typically in a conventional parking lot in this kind of setting, you typically have just drains in the middle of the parking lot, in the middle of the roadway, that would funnel that storm water into the storm system and into some big pond, probably behind the stores or out of sight. What they've done here is they've started to utilize the space in between the parking areas. So water flows in from the street and the driveway right into this apron here. Water then flows in through this vegetated area and flows through that space to where it overflows into a drop inlet. This is similar to a bioretention cell. We might call this a bioswale because basically we have biological vegetation here and it's conveying the water through here. It doesn't have as much storage on top as a bioretention cell. So we're having a little bit of volume capture and removal. In this design, I believe there is an under drain where some of that water can flow through and then be captured and then be filtered before it goes into the storm inlet. But otherwise, basically the stormwater runoff flows through this vegetated filter, removing a lot of the fine and coarse particles and helping to improve the water quality, sort of the first car on that treatment train before it goes into the stormwater system.
So really we're capturing as a first filter a lot of the fine particles. You can see some garbage in here that's being filtered out. So the water that actually makes it to the stormwater basin doesn't have to be treated as much because we're capturing quite a bit of that right here.
That's right. So think of those large stormwater basins as basically only having to be used for when we have those really large storm events where flooding may be an issue. So we've got to capture all that volume somewhere. But before it gets in there, when we have those really small storms that don't necessarily have to go into a flood mitigation area, we're able to kind of capture, filter, and treat a lot of that first amount of water runoff to remove those pollutants right here on the site and in the landscape.
So although this is one of those treatment train pieces, we talk sometimes about inline treatment versus offline treatment. So what's right. The difference and why might one be better than the other?
Well, inline treatment is basically when all the water would go through that practice and there might be some water that's retained here, but eventually all the water that comes off of this lot is going to end up going through here and into the main system.
So that's what we've got going here. This is
inline.
An inline system.
That's
all the
right.
Water has to flow through here, and although we might capture some of it,
that's right.
All the water still got to move through this pathway.
And there's always a risk that there could be something that gets resuspended or gets carried out through the end of the basin. That is one of the aspects of an inline system. An offline system, we could redesign this to where this fills up and then backs up into the roadway or backs up into this spillway and forces any extra runoff to bypass this and go into a larger stormwater receiving area. So anything that comes in here in the offline would stay in here and would not have any opportunity basically to be flushed back out into the main storm system.
And so the idea there is that the first flush or the most contaminated runoff from say a parking lot that accumulated material in between storm events would get captured,
right.
Stored here, and then later in the storm, as the cleaner water can't get in here anymore, can bypass but not essentially impact or add as much to the stormwater basin further downstream.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
So Mark, I wanted to show you this over here. I appreciate you walking over. You know, this is the overflow where the water that came into this bioswale would overflow and go into the main stormwater system. But as you see around the edge here, there's quite a bit of buildup of mulch, even some older pine straw that's collected here. This wood material here can float. That's one of the maintenance and management things that we have to take into account, these types of practices. It's kind of a very simple fix though. I mean,
mm-hmm.
This stuff floats. What we see in a lot of practices or other practices in places is you just have to have a skimmer around it. So basically water has to go, as the water rises, it rises above the bottom of that skimmer and the water has to flow under that and then over the top of the drop inlet structure to flow in it.
So anything floating gets caught,
that's
and doesn't go down
that's
the drain.
Right.
Yeah.
There are some other materials, maybe like a triple shredded hardwood has been used pretty effectively to not be a floating mulch material. But otherwise, basically a skimmer would be enough to keep this on site.
But really the key part that I just heard was that these ideas, although really good, have maintenance components that we need to work on. And so some added design might help to minimize this, basically the wood mulch that tends to want to float here from going in the hole.
Yep. Well, and the vegetation here, you notice it's fairly dense. So that works whenever, if the mulch does float and it's being moved, it works as a filter to hold it back as well.
Yeah.
So maintaining a thick stand of this vegetation will help to maintain that.